Now the Lord taketh us by his back and again we praise him back. Now the author of this previous psalm, I believe that he firmly, truly understood the immeasurable vastness of God's beauty, God's glory. And I firmly believe that Apostle Paul had very similar thoughts and emotions in his letter to Romans. If you follow me to Romans chapter 11, Paul writes this beautiful doxology, verses 32 to 36. He writes, "Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen." Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we come here to glorify you, to praise you, for you are almighty, all-knowing, all-wise. Father, there is no measure to your wisdom, to your knowledge. And it is such a comforting reality knowing that you are in full control, that whatever happens in our lives, and even today, Lord, we have peace in our hearts knowing that it is by your design. We praise you for that. We seek to glorify you in everything that we do. Lord, you saved us for your glory. And we sing to your glory, Lord. We worship you through your offering, through worship, through reading of scripture, through our daily lives. For that is what you have commanded us to do. And we want to do it. Lord, there are those who have not yet understood the beauty and the vastness of your majesty and your grace and your mercy. They're still in darkness, Lord. Have mercy on them and unveil their eyes and save them, Lord. Pray this in God's name.
Good morning, Grace Family Church. You may be seated for a few moments. I'd like to welcome all of you on this wonderful morning. And with some difficulties and trials that we're experiencing, it is a blessing, nonetheless, to be together as a church. We have a wonderful privilege of being here and worshiping our God as a congregation and brothers and sisters. I'd like to welcome especially our guests. Maybe if we have any guests in the room with us, would you mind simply raising your hand so we can see where you are? We have a guest right there to my left. Welcome. We are glad that you're with us this morning. And one special thing that we like to do is to encourage you to go to welcometogfc.com and just fill out a small questionnaire there. So that we can get to know you a little bit better and have the opportunity to pray for you as well. And hopefully you feel welcome this Sunday morning. Unfortunately, Coffee Corner, as we usually have open, where you can get yourself some coffee, is closed. But don't rush to leave after the service. Make sure to stick around and have some good fellowship. And we have a few announcements. We started this year off with a wonderful start, with a wonderful beginning. Throughout the first days of this year, this entire past week, all the way up to Friday, we were gathering together in the cafeteria in the main sanctuary to pray with everybody that came to church. If you were able to visit one of those prayer meetings, I'm sure it was a blessing to you. And let us continue this this thing that we began, this wonderful thing as a church, our responsibility, this a privilege that we can come to God in prayer. Let us continue to gather in small groups and other various places here as well in church. Continue praying. Now, a couple announcements throughout January. We had a wonderful start, and we have a wonderful plan for January. First things first, we have our church is offering an ESL class for immigrants or anyone that is desiring to learn English, or if you know anybody who would like to learn English, if your friends or family who can benefit from such a class, please invite them. The first class begins tomorrow, actually here at 7 p.m. Tomorrow at 7 p.m. in room 209. It's going to be upstairs. You can come by and just register on the spot, visit the ESL class. Next, on Saturday, January 21st, from 9 to 12:30, we're going to be having an all-church staff meeting. Your staff, if you are a leader of the church, if you are participating in any way, make sure to come by and join us in prayer Saturday, January 21st, from 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. The following day, on Sunday, January 22nd, we're going to be having our monthly family service, followed by a membership meeting. So make sure to put this down on your calendars, especially if you are a member of the church. Please make sure to attend. It's going to be very important. Topics that we're going to be touching on, announcements that will be made, that is Sunday, January 22nd at 6 p.m. Family service followed by members service. And then a little bit further into January, we've been announcing this Fathers and Sons Camp. The registration continues. The actual camp is happening January 26th through 29th. The topic, respect. This is open to all fathers and their children of any ages, as well as any brothers that are interested in attending. The cost is $150 per person. And you can register on our church website, gfchurch.com. And again, that's January 26th through 29th, Father and Son's Camp. Final announcement I'd like to make. This is moving into February, a very special course or class that we're going to be starting. It's Kairos. Many of you have heard this. This is an evangelism course. If you'd like to learn about evangelism, it is happening February 3rd through 12th. And if you're planning of attending, you've heard about this course, please make sure to register as soon as possible. It really simplifies all of the logistics that have to do with this class, since the course is heavily dependent on how many people actually register. So if you'd like to find out more about Kairos, the schedule that's going to be happening, or if you'd like to register, please visit gfckairos.com. That's K-A-I-R-O-S.com. And the last day to register, make sure don't delay, the last day to register is going to be January 15th, coming out next week. So again, that's Kairos. We highly encourage you to register, make sure to learn how to evangelize. Maybe this is something that you've been afraid of. This is something that you want to work on this year. Maybe it's your New Year's resolution to evangelize to more people. Make sure to register. It's February 3rd through 12th. Friends, brothers, and sisters, with that, I'd like to invite all of you to stand with me and pray. We'll continue our service with a long prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful Sunday that you blessed us to enjoy together. That even though we are experiencing some trials with the electricity being shut down, we thank you that you have blessed us to still be here. We ask that you would bless all of those who are not in attendance, that they would prayerfully turn to you and worship you as your Lord and as the Savior, because you deserve all the glory. Father, we thank you that you bless Grace Family Church with so many events and so many things happening here. We pray for every single one of these events that we mentioned in the announcements this morning, for every ministry, that your hand would be over this, God, that we would be empowered by the Holy Spirit as a church to serve this community and to edify the saints. God, I pray that when the word is preached this morning, God, that you would touch our hearts and that you would work in us and work out our sanctification for your glory. Bless us as we worship, as we worship in singing, as we worship in the listening and studying of your word, and as we worship in giving as well, and to understand that it is pleasing, Lord, when you see a cheerful giver. I pray that these resources would all go to your glory and bless us. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We'll be singing one more song, so if you have just arrived, please take out your phones to gfcsongs.com. We're going to sing a song called Jesus, Thank You. We read in Colossians chapter 3, verse 17, "And whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." We're going to be thanking him in song specifically for the fact that we can now be his children, that before we were his enemies, but today we are saved and we are seated at the table with him. This is a great opportunity for us to remember that because of the cross, we have been reconciled, we have been brought near to God, and we have a good, right relationship with him. So, of course, that is something we should be extremely grateful for. So let us sing the song, Jesus, Thank You. You can find it at gscsongs.com.
You heard the calling. seated. It's good to see you all in this wonderful, beautiful room. I want to invite you today to think, to consider a very interesting idea or topic. God's glory. God's glory is the sum effect of all His attributes. Think about it. Grace, truth, goodness, mercy, justice, knowledge, power, eternity. All that He is, God's glory is an essence of who God is. For example, a light. As a light to the sun. As the blue for the sky. Right? Or the wet for the water. Water is wet. You cannot make water wet. Think about it. You cannot make the sun light. Or you cannot make the sky blue. How many of you tried? You get up in the morning, get out, it's cloudy, I'm gonna make the sky blue today. Or the sun, I'm gonna make the sun shine. No, you cannot, because by nature, the sun produces light. By nature, water is wet. The water is wet. No, nobody argues with this, right? At least in the first service, nobody argued about that, those statements. The sun is the light, the sky is the blue, and the water is wet. You cannot make something that by nature itself is. And so the same thing with God's glory. God and His attributes. So in other words, God's glory is intrinsic to Him. Now this is different for us, because our glory is always granted to us. We are not glorious intrinsically. Think about it. Let's take an example. The most glorious position everyone is admiring is to be the king, right? Okay, imagine you guys have opportunity to be the king, or you've seen a king. Now, the king, let's say King of England, his glory is in what? In the position, in the crown, in the clothing. Yes. Now, for example, you take the king and you take the crown, you take everything away, and you just give him a rag to wear and kick him out to live on the streets for a week, and then you have a homeless person sitting next to that king, same dress, same smell, everything the same, you will not distinguish the king. But then if you take him back and wash him and shave him and put a new king clothes, you say, oh, here's the glorious king. Not with God. You cannot give the light to the sun. It's intrinsically glorious. God is glorious intrinsically. That's His nature. We as people, we're granted glory. God is the source of glory. And this is why, I'll tell you, one of the reasons why people don't submit, don't accept Jesus as their Savior and Lord. You know why? Because when God, the Son, came down to earth, He took on flesh. And willfully, He has hidden His glory inside. He would not reveal His glory. He put it on pause. And so people saw a man walking. Jesus. Well, I have all kinds of other people. Why should I worship you? And a lot of people rejected Jesus. Why should we worship you? Well, he put on pause. He has hidden within himself the glory that he has in order to become like us. And people got confused. And once in his life here on earth, he actually turned off the switch that he had for glory and invited people to see that glory. That event happened on the Mount Transfiguration. With that, I want to invite you to open to Luke, the Gospel of Luke. We continue our study in Luke chapter 9. We begin our reading for today in verse 28. The moment when Christ once took off the veil and revealed his glory, and then he has hidden it again. Let's look at this story. This is the word of God. Now about 8 days after these things, he took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep. But when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. As he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid, and they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my son, my chosen one, listen to him." And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent and told no one in those days anything what they had seen. Now, I want to begin with verse 35. Before we walk through this passage verse by verse, I want to draw your attention to verse 35, because it actually contains the key to understand the whole passage. And the voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my son, my chosen one, listen to him." Is this something new, or you have heard somewhere previously this phrase? Who can help me? Say again? Baptism. This is a very close phrase. I want you to go back. We already have covered that in Luke chapter 3. Just flip your pages to chapter 3, verse 22. I want you to see this, because there is a difference, and I want you to see the difference as I read it and actually tell me. This is important. I want you to make that discovery, because you will see the key how to understand the whole experience of on the Mount of Transfiguration. Here's chapter 3, verse 22. "And the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, saying, God the Father speaking from heaven, 'You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased.'" Now, let's go back to chapter 9, verse 35. "And a voice came out of the cloud saying, 'This is my Son, my chosen one. Listen to him.'" What's the main difference? There are some words that used differently. What's the main concept? That there's a difference. What's the difference? Who is talking to? In the first place, during baptism, God the Father is speaking directly to his Son. And that experience during baptism was important for the Son. In the beginning of his ministry, God the Father approves him, supports him, and says, "I'm going to be with you. You go, I'm right behind you." phase was important for the Son. Here, this is my beloved Son, my chosen one. Listen to him. Who is he addressing? Three disciples. So we need to understand that this whole experience is given specifically, crafted for disciples, just three of them. So we need to understand that this is the discipling moment. God works with three disciples. They met these four disciples. God reveals his glory, Christ's glory, to three men. Why? Why would we do it? Well, if you remember a month ago, we took a month break for Christmas messages, but when we were studying Gospel of Luke, the last message was about the cost and the value of discipleship, right? Look at verse 23, just a few verses prior to this. And he said to all, Jesus speaking to the crowd, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life would lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses or forfeits himself? So he speaks to the crowd and he talks about the following disciple. Would you follow me? You want to be my disciple? Well, how about this? Deny yourself. Take up your cross. Now, how many would be like, oh yes, we would love to deny ourselves. Oh, the cross, we love this. Cross is the place where people die. When Jesus mentioned that, I am more than sure his popularity went down. I don't think he got many likes on that statement, on his social account, the social media account. It was no likes on that statement. Deny yourself. Oh, like. No. Follow me. Take up my cross. No. And so popularity goes down after this. Down. Crowds were, when he fed 5,000, when people were fed, they were like, Jesus, you are awesome. We want to follow you. Then he says, deny yourself. Popularity goes down. 8 days later, disciples are like, ooh, where's the crowd? Everyone's gone. Is this all closing down? We thought the wave, Jesus' wave is just coming in and it's nothing. And God designed this experience to uplift disciples, to encourage them. This vision was designed and crafted specifically for disciples. And it's part of the discipleship that Jesus does to his disciples. Now, our elder board, 2 months ago, went on prayer retreat. We do it twice a year. And in November, we with elders went out of town for 3 days of prayer and studying the scripture. We studied the Gospel of John and prayed over it. And out of it came the vision. The vision that we brought from that retreat for our church for this year. If you remember, each January, we begin with the vision for the year. We want to focus on something specific. 2 years ago, it was the small groups. We talked about small groups. We encouraged people to sign up for small groups, and we continue to do that. And if you're not part of the small group, talk to pastors. We'll help you find the small group. This is where actually discipling and help and support and spiritual linkage happens with the church. We want you to be part of the small groups. We talk about it. Last year, we came with the vision, we need to encourage the church toward the evangelism. And with the whole year, we would apply the messages, we would encourage in many, many different ways, and we would even speak specifically about evangelism. We will continue to do this. Please do so. Invite people to church. Share your faith with others. This is the key. This year, we came with another vision. We continue those things, but we wanna make one extra step in discipleship, in discipling. It does exist. Even now, as I speak the word of God, it's partially discipleship. When you attend small groups, yes, you encourage one another. You open the word of God. You study it together. You disciple one another. Great. But we wanna make an extra step toward us meeting one-on-one in a coffee shop, on the way to school or to work, and disciple one another. We want all of us to be part of this process. And the reason for it is because it's biblical. We find it in the Bible. The Bible, the New Testament teaches about the new church, that they were meeting and they were encouraging one another, serving one another. More than that, Ephesians 4, 11, 12 says that God appointed evangelists, pastors, and teachers for what? Who can accomplish it? Finish that verse 12. Why do we have pastors and teachers? For what? Not for the work of ministry. That's what everyone thinks. This is why I need to care about this. For the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. Please don't skip that part of saints doing the ministry. Because that's actually a misconception. A lot of people in America think they think that they have pastors to do the work and we come and applause. Not the New Testament concept. In the New Testament, pastor's job is to equip people to do the work. Not that we're lazy, we don't work. Because equipping actually is ministry in itself. If you think about it, if you want to really disciple your kids, you know you're going to sweat. It's a lot of work. And pastors need to sweat and work in order to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. That's Ephesians 4:12. Now, if someone comes up to church and says, "Pastor, we don't have this ministry in church," you know my response from now on will be like, you already guessed it, right? I will say, "Please forgive me, my friend, that I have not equipped you yet to do that ministry. Can we start now? I'm going to be equipping you to do that ministry that you just mentioned that we don't do it. I'm so sorry, I haven't done that." That's our responsibility. That's the way church is built. Through disciples. This is why this year you will hear this word over and over. Now, as I was thinking after that retreat 2 months ago, we came and I was thinking, okay, preparing. How are we going to start this year? I was preparing a three-sermon series on this, but then I scratched it. And the reason why? Because as I was preparing then for the Luke and how we're going to continue the Gospel of Luke, I looked at Luke, and in chapter 9, chapter 10, 11, Luke speaks about discipleship like never before. Actually, in the Gospel of Luke at this time, and we mentioned that a month ago, that Jesus, he fed crowds, he preached to the crowds, but in the middle of his ministry, he leaves behind. Yes, he occasionally would speak to the crowd, but he takes the 12, he takes the 3, he takes the 70 disciples, and specifically begins to work with them to prepare them when he will be crucified and then go up in heaven. He's going to leave them to lead the ministry. So he is discipling from now on a specific group of people. And I was like, why should we come up with another discipling sermon series if it's right here in the Gospel? And so this is why we're coming back. So this is the introduction. Okay. So today's passage is part of discipleship. And one main element of Christian discipling is that it must at some point get all the way to the glory of Christ. Here's the difference. There's so many coaching happening outside. You want to go to gym? You're going to get assigned a coach. They will coach you how to work out. You want to start a business? You go and meet with the coach. They need to coach you in the ministry, in the business. You want to do a health? You want to do yoga, whatever? There will be always a coach. Is this what we're talking about here? No. Christian discipling is not coaching. Because it begins with a view and experience of God's glory. And something, what? You come to gym? Okay, first you need to see Jesus' glory. You will never have that in gym. But you must have that in church. This is what's so different about discipling within the church. And so today's question that I want to answer is, how can we help people see and experience the glory of Christ? Because it is part of Jesus discipling the group of 12. So number one step, this is how you will be able to lead your family, your children, your wife, your ministry, your friends, whoever you disciple into God likeness. You begin with the prayer. The prayer. Verse 28. Look at verse 28, part of 29. Now about 8 days after these things, he took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mount to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered. As he was praying, the glory was revealed. Think about it. We already mentioned that a number of times when we run into baptism. During baptism, Jesus was praying. When he was choosing, he was setting apart 12 disciples, he prayed that night. When his crucifixion was approaching, he knew that Peter will deny him, and he said, Simon, Satan asked to sift you like wheat, but I prayed for you. In Gethsemane, he was praying, and his sweat was like drops of blood on the cross when he was dying. He said, Father, in your hands, I give up my spirit. Seems like every crucial moment in his ministry, Jesus would pray, and every time you see him praying, you should expect great things to happen. And so when we begin to read and you don't know what happens, you say, Jesus is going up on the mountain to pray. Something great. Christ's glory will be revealed. This is very important. This passage connects the prayer and the glory. You pray, you see the glory. You pray, others see glory. Practically, you know, many of you have attended this week. We had a week-long prayer meetings. Every evening, 7 o'clock, we had prayer meetings in that auditorium, and we prayed. We want to begin the year with prayer. I want to invite you to continue on and turn this week, prayer week, into prayer month. And pray daily. Why don't you just every evening at 7 o'clock and from 7 to 8, you pray at home. You conduct services at your home. You pray. We have Thursday prayer meetings. Every Thursday we have at 7:30 prayer meetings. Join. Pray. As a matter of fact, I was thinking, you probably have heard it so many times that you should pray that you don't even listen to me right now. It's just like, we've heard it so many times. And so instead of me talking, I want to invite you to experience this. Because I believe this Word of God can be active and working the same way as it did 2,000 years ago tonight, or this morning. So I want to invite you to stand, and I will pray before I continue, because the revelation of Jesus' glory should happen only and will happen only if we pray. I want to pray. Join me. Father, sometimes simple things don't get us excited. We want something deep, something extra glorious. We'll get to that. But it gets there, we get there through simple, mundane things like regular prayer. This is why we pray. Every time we open the Word of God, it's not just an exercise, it's part of the service. This is the moment when we can encounter Christ's glory. This is why I want to pray. Jesus was praying, and disciples experienced His glory. We want to experience the same glory now here. Would you reveal your glory to all of us today? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. The next step we find in next verse, or in verse 28, is exclusivity. This is not a popular word in our days. When you exclude some people. Look at verse 28. Now about 8 days after these sayings, he took with him Peter and John and James. That's it. And I was reading, I was like, Jesus, where's the crowd? You came for people. Where are at least 12? Put yourself in those who were not invited to the party. What would you say? You would say, not fair. What about me? Or if you were invited, like in our days or now, what about them? Jesus, what about them? Why are not? They're not included. It's not fair. Well, let's be honest. When we talk about preaching the gospel to everyone, but when we talk about discipling, it implies that discipler, the one who disciples, strategically separates only a fraction of the people. You cannot disciple everyone. That's not discipleship. That's a crowd. Discipling assumes few. Now, the help for us, we have two people invited to this party. Jesus is going to reveal His glory. Three disciples are invited. Two more people come. Moses and Elijah. Think about Moses and Elijah. What's so common with them? Both of them were very exclusivist. Moses, out of the whole nation of Israel, picked Joshua and invested in him for 40 years. So that when Moses was gone, Joshua took the nation into the promised land. Elijah, also, he didn't take a lot of people. He worked, he preached to crowds, he healed, he did miracles to a lot of people, but he discipled only Elisha, only one. So discipling in the Old Testament, discipling in the New Testament is always exclusive. You cannot be effective. You say, no. The marketing of our days is that more people you cover, the better the strategy is. He says, no. Not with me. It's not the number of people, but the intensity of experience of few that changes the whole thing. See, we're thinking, we need to cover a lot of people. Jesus says, no, why don't I have only three people and their lives transformed? And that will turn the whole world upside down. Instead of me just broadcasting it over the whole world. And so if you're investing in just one child, in few people in your small group, or just one person that you're meeting week after week, and you're thinking, my ministry is not great. Jesus says, that's exactly how I do it. Why are you stressing about it? You invest in one person and change him, open his eyes to see God's glory. You will accomplish more than you will cover 10,000 people with a shallow information. Go deep. And the intensity of experience will transform, not the amount of people covered. Think about it. Discipling is exclusive. Number three, personal experience. When you disciple, you and your student must have experience. Look at verse 32, 29 and on. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem, at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep. But when they became fully awake, they saw his glory. And the two men who stood with him, they saw. This is amazing. This is what's worth the ticket. Now, in order to understand the awesomeness of this experience, we need to understand who were invited to this party. Moses. Do you know why these two people were invited? Moses and Elijah? They were invited because they were not shocked on Mount Transfiguration. If you invite me or you, if you will be invited to that event, we will be shocked. Jesus, such a close. Can I see through? Can I light you know, the dark spots, you know, on the mountain? I will be fascinated, and I will be distracted from the main thing. But Moses, if you remember in Exodus, he went up on the Mount Sinai for 40 days, and the cloud covered, and he saw God face to face and talked, and he experienced that. And when he comes back and Jesus is in glory, he says, I've seen that, nothing new. Elijah, remember Elijah, who withstood 400 false prophets, had them all killed. Then he had depression. And then God sends angels, says, go for 40 days to the Mount Horeb, which is actually the same Mount Sinai. He comes there and God appears to him and he speaks to him. He speaks to him and reveals his glory. Now you say, well, Moses experienced, Elijah experienced God's glory, and they came to underline that. Now Peter, John and James are invited to see this glory. I get that. What about me now here living in Sacramento? Where's that mountain? Can I walk for 40 days and be there? You don't have to. You don't have to. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. You can. You can experience the same glory. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, beginning verse 15. Yes, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Veil that covers Jesus' glory. Verse 17, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we, oh, that's you, me included, awesome. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So this is amazing. This is where you can be part of this experience now. How? Very simple. Verse 15 says, to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. The people who don't want to hear the gospel, those who don't read the gospel, the veil is covering their hearts and they don't see the glory. They're just like, whatever, church is boring. Verse 16, but when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed and he gets the glory. He sees the glory. This is the process that every believer walked through. And if you say, I didn't, we're gonna, at the end of our service, invite you into that experience. But it happens only when you stop reading the Moses and read the gospel. When you read the gospel. Now, if we go back to Luke 9, in verse 31, it's interesting comment made, and that's a hint for you, my friend. Who appeared in glory, oh, I want to see glory, and spoke of his departure. Now, the word departure in Greek literally sounds like this, Exodus. Do you know that word Exodus? Greek word Exodus. That's the word that's used to give the name for the second book in the Bible, the book of Exodus. The Bible begins with Genesis, then Exodus. The word Exodus is the Greek word used right here. And he, Moses and Elijah speaking to Jesus, and they're appearing in glory and spoke of his Exodus. Why would you use this word? Well, strategically. Because Exodus means to leave, to walk out, to die. This is what happened when Moses was sent by God to take out Israel. They need to exit, they need to get out, and they die to that life and they walk out. Well, Jesus is gonna lead his people out of slavery, out of bondage of sin. How? By dying, by Exodus. So you want to see the glory? Who appeared in glory and spoke of his Exodus. This is the key. You understand why Jesus died. Die for your sins. I like to do fireworks. Only on legal days, okay. I used to live in Vancouver and there were no limits on fireworks. Here it's like, what, 3 feet of the ground? Just, come on. Still, I like to do fireworks for two reasons. One is that I like to blow up things. Sorry, confession. But second, I like fireworks because when I blow up things, I can see the joy and reflection of that excitement in the eyes of my boys. And I think I get more pleasure even seeing them enjoying it, or whoever comes to the fireworks show that we put on. The excitement of people watching, I think, gives me more pleasure than even the fire itself that I produce. God loves to reveal his glory. He is more pleased to see that glory reflect in the eyes of his excited disciples. This is what he does. He wants to see their excitement go up. He wants his glory to transform and change them. They need to experience this. I want them to experience this. And God could not hold it. He said, you know what, disciples? I know Jesus' glory will be awesome in heaven, but I cannot wait. I'm going to give you a little preview here on Mount Transfiguration. I want you to see that. You know why it's important? Most of his disciples died a martyr death. They died for that. You don't die for information, for theory. You die only if you experience something. They experience. They say, you know what? I'll die for Jesus. And they died. Persecution was hard on them. But this event gave them energy, strength to withstand. Have you seen the fireworks of Jesus' glory? And that gets you excited. You say, I will do anything. Fourth step, I like this because I screw up occasionally. I called it room for mistakes. One more step toward helping people see Jesus' glory is you allow them to make mistakes, room for mistakes. Look at verse 33. This is right in the middle of this glorious moment. One of the guys just screwed up. Look at verse 33. And as the men were parting from him, Peter, come on, when is the time to be silent? This is the time. Don't say anything. Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And Luke helps us, not knowing what he said. He missed the point. Off the topic. I don't know. Have you been in this situation? You're attending a small group and discussion goes, and then you say something and somebody crickets like, he's not with us. He missed the boat. He's not connecting. We're talking about, you know, how to do this, and he's just, what about flowers? Squirrel. That kind of attitude. What's interesting, I'm reading this. Just imagine the situation. Moses, big guy, believe me. Elijah, big guy. Jesus, it's kind of like you're sitting in front of three presidents and they're having a conversation and you just, you better be silent right now. He's like, oh, can I put some input? Why don't we build some tents? I'm done. I'm so glad Moses was invited, not me. If I were talking with them, excuse me, Moses, Elijah, Jesus are having a conversation. Peter, who are you? You lead 2 million people for 40 years and then you talk, okay? Or Elijah, perform some miracles, heal some people, raise some people from the dead, then you interrupt me, I'm sorry. But they were mature. I'm so glad Moses and Elijah were there. They were mature and they would, what? And I like that. They would let Peter make mistakes. He was off topic. They're talking about Exodus, glory, sacrifices. He says, tents. Hey, I'm a construction guy. He's talking about saving people. He's talking about tents. You know that in discipling, in working with people, you should let them make mistakes. And if you see some people or you interact with people, wrong, you can't do this. By saying that, you know what the people say? I'm not the mentor. Please don't listen to me because I cannot help you. Run away from such people. We should be able to talk about our own mistakes and allow other people to make mistakes. Yeah, we all do that. On stage, sometimes at the concert, sometimes at the wedding. Just imagine what Jesus, what Peter did. It's kind of like a wedding, and everyone is nice, and then some workers in the venue didn't know, and then the tractor just behind me. Sorry guys, continue on. That's what Peter does. Jesus did not interrupt him. Moses did not interrupt him. Elijah let him speak. I will shut him down. Three of them allowed him to make that mistake, public mistake documented for us. And then got the Father's response. Peter, can I get your attention? Then God the Father speaks and corrects. He corrects Peter. The last one. The last step is the work of the Word. The whole discipling must lead us toward the Word of God. Look at verse 34 and on. As he was saying these things, Peter, please don't. But he was, because Jesus would let his disciples make mistakes. It's part of the counsel. It's part of discipling. You let them screw up. Then you can help them. As he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, Peter, this is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him. Stop talking. And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. When God reveals His glory, He always talks. This is interesting. If we go back to Jesus revealing His glory in the Old Testament, God revealing His glory in the Old Testament, Elijah, remember he went on the Mount of Horeb, Sinai, and God said, listen, I'm going to reveal to you myself. And how he does? He speaks to him. He speaks to him. I am not in earthquake. I'm not in fire. I'm not in stormy wind. I'm in a quiet whisper. Now, when I want to read one story that happened with Moses, let's go back to Exodus, now in chapter 33, Exodus 33. So, I mentioned that we read the passage where Moses experienced God's glory on the mountain. And there was a moment when God gave him the Ten Commandments. He comes down, and in 40 days, Israelites fell in sin. And they left God, and they were just worshiping idols. And he breaks the Ten Commandments. The whole story leads to God saying, you know what? I'm going to give the second chance. You need to come up. I will give you another set of tablets. I will give you another set of Ten Commandments. And at that moment, Moses cannot wait and says, God, can you do some favor for me? I want to read this. Exodus 33, verse 18. Moses said, please, show me your glory. And he, speaking of God, said, I will make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But he said, you cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and die and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock. And I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. So, amazing. Moses says, can I see glory? He says, okay, I will, but you cannot see me up front. You will see me from the back. That's understandable. But then, if you read the story, you don't find that experience. What do you find? What do you find? Well, next chapter, 34, verse 4. So Moses cut two tablets of stone like the first, in order to receive a new engravings, a new Ten Commandments. And he rose early in the morning and went up on Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hand two tablets of stone. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there. And he was like, uh-oh, he's gonna cover me with my hand, with his hand, then he's gonna pass by, and I will see him from the back. That's what you would expect, but this is what happened. And proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed. This is what he's proclaiming. The Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and full faithfulness, keeping steadfast law for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but who will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation. Do you know what happened after? After God revealed himself in speech, Moses went down and his face was shining. He had to cover it with veil. God, we want to see God, and we see Him by hearing Him. This is what happened with Elijah. This is what happened with Moses. And if we go back to our experience on Mount Transfiguration, yes, they saw his glory shining. But what's more important, God speaking to Peter and his buddies, this is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him. You know what was wrong with Peter? When he was saying, let's build three tents. Not that he was leaving himself out, not including himself, just Jesus, Moses, and Elijah, three tents. No. The problem is that he leveled Moses, Elijah, and Jesus on the same level. Says three tents. And this is what God the Father corrects in Peter's mind. He says, this is my son. Look at the middle. This is my son. Listen to him. Leave behind Moses and Elijah. Great men. A lot of truth. Listen to my son. Don't focus on three tents. There must be only one. Jesus. In the last days, God in many ways, through many people, have spoken. Hebrews begin. But in the last days, he has spoken to us in his Son. This is the Word. The Word of God became flesh. Listen, the way we experience God's glory, Christ's glory nowadays, is through the Word of God. Know what's interesting? Verse 36. And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent and told no one. He would say, that's the time when you experience something, when you saw something great, you want to go and talk. Not this time. In Matthew 17, 9, Jesus tells them not to talk. Why? Because people would misunderstand. They would misinterpret. They would say, oh, we want a political leader. And hearing this glory, they would say, oh, we need a president like this. We need a king like this. So let's just make him a king. Jesus didn't want that attention. He came to die and become the king of the souls. That's why Matthew mentioned that. Luke doesn't mention that. Because there's another reason why Peter and disciples were silent. Because experiences like this are not to be proclaimed, but rather reflected upon. You see, when you experience glory like this, you don't run and talk. You seek and reflect. In silence, you reflect, think, and ponder. This is what Peter and disciples did. This is why Luke underlines this. He says, nobody told them to do this. They knew at this time, this is something to ponder about, think about, reflect. This is what biblical discipling does. Discipleship inevitably leads to Christ's glory, inevitably. But this is the experience to reflect upon, to think, and you understand. It's interesting. Years passed. Peter writes the letter. Second Peter. I often quote it. This is where his reflection upon this glory led him to. I want to invite you to Second Peter. This is the same guy who saw this glory, sat down, and reflected for hours on this. He was silent. He didn't speak for years. And then he writes about it. And this is how he would, after reflecting upon this, looking back, this is how he, what he took out of this experience. And I want you to take the same. We are disciples of Jesus. We should learn the same lesson as Peter did. 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning verse 16. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. We saw the glory, in other words. For when he received God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." We ourselves heard this very voice before, born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. Here's the conclusion. And we now, including believers, we have something more sure, the prophetic word to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a darker place, in dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Amazing. This is what reflection upon seeing Christ's glory produced in Peter. He pondered, thought, and concluded, nothing better than the Word of God. Nothing better than the Word of God. Says we've experienced, we saw that glory. And you can be part of that experience. Pay attention to the Word of God. This is how you become a disciple. This is how you stay a disciple. This is where you see the glory. This is where you need to lead every disciple. You take the Word and lead them to the glory of Christ. That's what biblical discipleship is. Now, I want to end with an invitation. Maybe you are visiting us. Maybe you've attended church for years. Maybe for today, your veil over your heart, over your eyes was lifted. And you saw the glory of God. You saw Jesus' glory. And it's something more valuable than fireworks. You saw the light. Don't just set it apart. Repent and turn to him in prayer, and he will accept you and forgive you and make you into disciple of Jesus. This is more valuable than what the world can offer. Amen? I want to invite you to stand as we pray. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful that we can see ourselves in you. We make mistakes. We're often off topic. We miss the target. We miss the point so many times. But at such a crucial moment, such a glorious moment, you invited people like Peter, who can miss the target and be part of that experience. Only gracious God can do this. This is why we're here. You have invited us to this glorious party. When you reveal your glory to us, and often you allow us to make mistakes. This is how we grow as disciples. We learn more about you and your patience and love and grace. We pray for those who, maybe for the first time, truly understood that Jesus is not mere man like everyone else. And today we just looked at a little preview of what is to come. And it is a glorious future. And the Mount Transfiguration, it's just a sneak peek into what is to come. Would you invite them into this glory? Would you give them a hunger for that glory? Because in it, there is a forgiveness of sins. That Exodus was done for us. And we can be part of this when our sins are forgiven. And that's light shining. When our conscience is clean. When our mind is purified, and we can relate to people, we can enjoy life, and we can have hope of eternity. That's an experience more glorious than anything. Invite those people into fellowship, And those who already have experienced this, may we just sit and reflect. How often we want to run, how often we want to speak, but the voice from heaven reminds, listen, listen to him. Don't speak, don't say, just ponder what a glorious Savior would be. In whose name we pray. Amen. This concludes our service. Enjoy fellowship and God bless you.